So I tried to figure out a way to say something un-redneck. And so I figured this, it's Nike commercial, so that's un-redneck, right? They're out of like New York or something, eh? Wait, that's not even New York. I don't know. So the concept is just do it. And if you ever thought about how many times we have an idea what God wants us to do, and then we start thinking. We do that whole thing where, you know, we know what God wants, but we start thinking about it. We start reasoning and we go, you know, what would happen? And I always like the thought, I love yellow pine. I've been around the building trying to find yellow pine, and I don't know why I think yellow pine is the greatest stuff in the world. But if we get to thinking about it, we're going to do something where we start reasoning through it. And the problem with reasoning through things is this. Usually find something to be afraid of. So I was thinking about all things like that, and I was like, well, it could slide one direction, it could slide the other. Well, obviously it's a piece of wood, so if I jump on it, it's probably going to break at some point in the future. And then I got to thinking about it, well, what if, you know, I hurt my ankle? You know, we all, you know, an injury. And then, you know, every day I get to worry about, oh, one day that's going to start hurting. One day it's going to get worse. One day, one day, one day. And we do that thing where we outthink those things that we know we need to be doing in the first place. And there's this concept that came out a few years ago, it's called a 10-second rule. You figure out what God wants you to do, and within 10 seconds, do it. Because at that point, you have figured out all those crazy reasons why you shouldn't do it. All those reasons that would keep you from doing what God, you know God wants you to do. So you don't go, and go, well, let me reason through everything I should be afraid of. Because that's what it is. When we say we're going to sit back, and most of the time, we'll even show in the throw in the church answer. I don't know if you've heard it. It's where we use prayer as an excuse. I'm going to pray about that. Well, I know God wants me to do it. I'm going to pray about that. You know, I see somebody, you know, on the side, and I know I have this feeling, and I know that I need to help them. I'm going to go pray about that. Good news is they'll be gone after I'm finished praying, so it's okay, right? And we have this, and it becomes prayer almost as an excuse. And if we did the 10-second concept, it's where we know what God wants us to do. We don't really think about it. We just do those things that God leads us to do. And the answer is, I think we would do a lot more if we didn't think about all the risks and all the costs and everything that could go wrong. And tonight I want you to consider something. They succeed in this story. And I want you to see why they succeed. They have very little going for them. Let me rehash a little bit from last week. Generally, they sent a letter to the king and said, and the king said, stop. If they do anything, make sure and stop them. They pretty much have an edict from the king that if they start rebuilding this temple, they need to go. They need to be taken care of so that they can protect the king. But that's not how it works. They get led, and they get on fire. We are in Ezra, chapter 5, page 473 in the Old Testament. It's not the New Testament number. Ezra, chapter 5. Now the prophets, Haggai and Zechariah, the son of Iddo, prophesied to the Jews who were in Judah and Jerusalem in the name of God of Israel, who was over them. Then Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, and Jeshua, the son of Jozadak, arose and began to rebuild the house of God that is in Jerusalem. And the prophets of God were with them, supporting them. At the same time, Tattenai, the governor of the province beyond the river, and Shethar Bozni and their associates came to them and spoke to them. Thus, who gave you a decree to build this house and to finish this structure? They also asked them, what are the names of the men who are building this building? But the eye of their God was on the elders of the Jews, and they did not stop them until the report should reach Darius, and then an answer be returned by letter concerning them. It's not like they waited for an answer from Darius. That's what I want you to get. They had a prophecy. It's one of those where God told them to do something, and they felt that calling, and God speaks to them, and they just do it. They don't wait for Darius to come back with the answer that says, well, yeah, you can do it. They just start. They get this idea to do something, and they don't wait and go through all the things. And what they're doing here is, I mean, I want you to see what they're doing to them. They're like, okay, well, who gave you permission to do this? You don't have permission to do it. Call them out. Then he says, what are your names? Let me take a list of names so you can specifically get in trouble. It's always one of those, you know, when you're about to get in trouble and they're like, I need a list of names. And you're trying to figure out what your name is that day. You're like, I'm Bob the Builder. Okay. Remember, write that down. Bob the Builder. Got it? Okay, that's me. And it's one of the... I love cartoons. I apologize. It's my bad. No, but it's this idea that they're calling out names. And what it is he's saying, I'm going to hold you responsible. You're going to get in trouble. I'm writing down your name. It's going on the board. You're in trouble. And it says this. But the eye of their God was on the elders of the Jews. And they did not stop. It's this idea that they knew what to do, and so they did it. They didn't think about it. They didn't wait till a safer time. They didn't wait for anything. It's not that they didn't believe God would take care of it. It's that they didn't care. They decided they were going to do something, so they did it. And then, after they've already started, the letter comes. Ezra, chapter 5, verse 6. This is a copy of the letter that Tatanai, the governor of the province beyond the river, and Shithbar, Bosnia, and his associates, the governors who were in the province beyond the river, sent to Darius the king. They sent him a report in which was written as follows. To Darius the king, all peace. Be it known to the king that we went to the province of Judah, to the house of the great God. It is being built with huge stones and timbers laid in the walls. This work goes on diligently and prospers in their hands. Then we asked those elders and spoke to them thus, who gave you a decree to build this house and to finish this structure? We also asked them their names for your information that we might write down the names of their leaders. And this was their reply to us. We are the servants of the God of heaven and earth, and we are rebuilding the house that was built many years ago, which a great king of Israel built and finished. But because our fathers had angered the God of heaven, he gave them to the hand of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, the Chaldean, who destroyed the house and carried away the people to Babylon. He continues in verse 13. However, in the first year of Cyrus, king of Babylon, Cyrus the king made a decree that this house of God should be rebuilt. And the gold and silver vessels of the house of God, which Nebuchadnezzar had taken out of the temple that was in Jerusalem, and brought into the temple of Babylon, these Cyrus the king took out of the temple of Babylon, and they were delivered to one whose name was Sheshbazzar, whom he had made governor. And he said to him, take these vessels, go and put them in the temple that is in Jerusalem, and let the house of God be rebuilt on his site. Then this Sheshbazzar came and laid the foundations of the house of God that is in Jerusalem. And from that time until now, it has been in building, and it is not yet finished. Therefore, if it seems good to the king, let search be made in the royal archives there in Babylon to see whether a decree was issued by Cyrus the king for the rebuilding of the house of God in Jerusalem, and let the king send us his pleasure in this matter. I love the answer. The answer is we're servants of God. It's not a matter of any other thing, and nothing even comes into play. The only thing that comes into play is they only have one answer. Who gave me this authority? We are servants of God. And we are so slow to seize on that and say we are servants of God. Because I hate to tell you, our term Christian has lost almost all meaning in our society. It starts out as a byword, a curse word, an insult that we took on. Thought it was beautiful to be insulted for our Lord. Today has lost most of that meaning. It has to do with shiny crosses and jewelry and necklace and describing things. We have Christian everything. There are Christian artists. I don't know, they paint differently, I guess. There are Christian musicians. There are Christian everything. And it has just become a word. And yet you see it thrown around so much that it only has to do with things that relate to Christ as this positive word. This positive word to describe it, meaning it's not secular, it's something that Christians have. It's their version. It's Christian books. It's Christian artists. Christians magazines, Christian everything. And it just became an adjective instead of being an insult. And yet, the term servant still carries the same weight. Because in it, we humble ourselves. And a servant doesn't say to the king, let me check that out. How annoying would it be to have somebody who worked for you and you're like, okay, I want you to go do this job. And they go, okay, let me go run the numbers. I'm going to go see how badly I could get hurt. You come to work one day and you want to roof a house and they say, well, let me run the numbers. I want to know how bad it's going to hurt when I fall. Where's the closest hospital? And they just make this list. And they're like, okay, I'm ready to go 2 hours later. None of us would be happy with a worker who comes to work and says, you know what, I'm going to work once I'm fully satisfied. Once you've given me everything and you have answered all my little pet peeves and everything else and made me perfectly happy, I'm going to work. No, it's this idea that they are servants of the God of heaven and earth. Still carries the same weight. To say that we are servants should carry the same weight that it did for them, where you come out and you say, I don't have time to run the numbers. I don't have time for fear. I don't have an ability to fear. And this is what I love. God says that He gave us a spirit. And that spirit is not of fear. It's not timid or afraid. Now, if we're afraid, then we're not working for one spirit. There's more than one spirit.
Don't worry.
Got all on the dark side just now. We don't talk about it much. We don't talk about the power of Satan. We don't talk about the evils of knowledge. We don't talk about those evil dark forces. I guess we assume they just don't happen anymore. We assume that Satan is not powerful anymore and he, you know, hangs out in a little cage or something. He hangs out in hell, because that's a logical concept. And what we've done is we created this idea that we could have Christianity, and Christianity means almost nothing. Because we can have Christians who are afraid. Those aren't Christians. They serve a different spirit. Fear is when we are serving the wrong spirit. Because God specifically tells us about His Spirit. And if they had any bit of fear in this, there is no way they could have answered the way they did. They would have come up to the first time, He's like, okay, who's your leaders? Who are those specifically who are going to stand up and lead this group? Give me their names. So that when I go to the king, I can make sure it's clear to him who he needs to take care of. And the logic for most of us there is to say, I mean, it's not that smart at that point to keep working. At the point you're about to be found out by the king, and the king has already threatened your life, and your name is about to be handed to him, it's just not smart. It doesn't fit the wisdom of the age. It doesn't fit this earth logic. It doesn't fit the spirit of timidity. It doesn't fit the spirit that we have, this evilness that is around us. It doesn't fit any of it. And when we come before God and we say we are His servants, because every time we close a sermon, I always start with the most powerful expression. Jesus is Lord. The King of God. King of righteousness. King of peace. King of Salem. Melchizedek. We start with these things, and yet we don't live like it. How many of us live like we're actually in a kingdom? How many of us spend time to remember we're servants of our King? At the end of the day, black and white, blue and red, we're servants of the King. No matter who we are or what we do, to respond that way and to not wait for permission. Because that's what they're doing right here. They get permission. They send it to Darius, and then they have permission at this point, and they didn't wait for it. They didn't wait for it. They didn't do that thing we love to do where we put it off. That thing we love to do where we say, you know what, I'm going to do that when I'm satisfied. Or when God has given me what I want, at that point I will finally serve Him. The truth is, don't think. Because what thought is this. It's my mind trying to outthink God, and at the end of the day, I'm as stupid as I started. The older I get, the realize I'm actually dumber than I thought I was a year ago. Every year, I figure out I'm a little bit dumber. And I figure by the time I'm 70, I'm going to be like, I don't even know my name. I thought it was this, but I'm pretty sure it probably isn't. They're just lying to me. And that's how every year I realize that the more I try to use my logic, my wisdom, my knowledge, the more I try to do that, I realize all I'm doing is saying, God, let me show you how smart I am. And then realize what He said about that. He's going to make foolish the wisdom of this world. Foolish. And we wait for His permission. Because we don't understand our king. They didn't wait for this king. This King Cyrus, who's in charge, who can give out rules, who can do all this great things, and you have to kill. Oh, that's not. And yet God spoke of something, and He said something. These words are very powerful. He said, do not fear those who can kill the body, but do not the near soul. But fear Him who can destroy both body and soul in hell. That's the difference between our king and some earthly king. Some earthly rules. Some earthly ruler. And it's this right there. Fear Him who has the power of everything. Because if we're afraid only of God, and we let everything go beside us, and the only thing we care about is our king, then we're not going to act like Christians. We're going to act like servants of the God of heaven and earth. And we're going to take that term Christian and we're going to steal it back from our world that's taken it and made it mean a way of describing things. We're going to take it back and we're going to say, you know what? We don't even want to use the word Christian. I like the idea of translating everything in the Bible. I don't even like the term baptism. I like immersion so nobody gets confused. I mean, if we translated that, people would get less confused. You know, they quit throwing water at people's heads. Pouring buckets of water on people's heads. I've done both. It was really weird. If we actually said, and we said, you know what, the Bible says that, but I'm actually going to translate the word, and I'm going to say immersion, because that's what it means. Baptism. Dip. When I dip, you dip. Dip. And Christian is one of those words that we've just kind of let go there, and we never translated it. But instead walk in and say, I'm a little Christ. I'm a little Christ. And we take that word and we take it to its real meaning and we say, I'm a little Christ. I belong to Christ. I'm just a little version of Him. And we quit using all these church terms and we start replacing them with real terms. King. When's the last time you heard of King? When's the last time you really thought of your King? Not just, oh, He's God, He's in a distant, and the term God works, but it has this idea of Him being so distant. But yet we have the term King and His kingship and His kingdom that He establishes, that He is establishing, that we're a part of, that we belong to. And we look at this kingdom and we say, you know what, there's a lot of earthly kings and none of them matter. Because I will tell you, people can kill you. It's one of those sad realities. People can kill you. People can persecute you. People can do all kinds of things to you. And all of them were under threat of death. And they didn't wait until they were fully satisfied. And yet, how many of us are okay saying, I'm a slave? Let's be fair. Let's use the real terms. Let's use terms we understand. Don't use terms in the Bible that we just don't get. Let's use terms in the Bible we understand. Slavery. We get that one, right? We have a master who we serve, who we don't get to say, I don't feel like doing it today. We have a king who we serve, who we don't get to say, you know what, God, I've done this for you. Isn't that good enough? He's still the king at the end of the day. When Ezekiel talks about them as watchmen, when he speaks of them as watchmen, and he doesn't say, you've been a good watchman, you watched. He doesn't say, you did really good at the start. He doesn't say anything like it. He only talks about the end. He talks about those who have started off strong and fallen away, and it's just as bad as if they never started before. Jesus said it the same way. He just said, you know, don't come after me. Don't follow me. Don't do it. Go. Go to your house. You're not ready. You're not willing. That's the way he treats it. But then it talks about those who, they live recklessly, and they don't serve God, and then at the end they serve God. And those are righteous. And living under a king should change the way we live. Because it changes who we are. And Jesus has a lot of parables and a lot of stories, and in all those stories, there's one thing that's true. Is that if we mistake God for anything less than king, and us just different slaves, then we miss out on everything. If we miss out, and we start to have those who are elevated, those who think they know something, the secret knowledge, Bible speaks of Gnosticism. One of them words we don't like to translate. That secret knowledge. It's where we know something, we have this secret knowledge, and God has revealed something to me, and the answer is this, I know something you don't. And they used it as this, I am better than you. And it was not about humility, it was not about using what you know to serve others, it was about using what you know to defend yourself, to protect yourself. And that whole concept of going, well, let me think about what I shouldn't do, what I'm supposed to do. Let me think about 500 reasons why I know better than God. And it's all worthless. Completely and totally worthless. Because Christianity has become so much a joke. It has. Our world sees Christianity as a joke. They don't have a clue what Christianity is anymore. Because we don't show it anymore. Christianity is a title we bear, and you know, it's one of those things. One time I got right with the Lord. And that's our Christianity. It's not about Jesus being Lord, it's about Jesus was Lord at one point. And when we use terms like, I was saved, with a D. I was saved. Instead of him doing a continual work in which Christ is continually cleansing us and continually renewing us and continually working, in which Christ is doing all this work for us, in which we just hold on to him and he does all the work. And we cling to him and he continues to save us. We talk about a past event. We talk about one day. And they could say, they could have said it right here. They could have said, you know what? We started, we tried to build the house of God. Hooray, let's throw a little party for ourselves. We tried. Don't worry, they told us to stop, so we did. But we tried. They encouraged us that they would kill us. Oh, so we stopped. Yay, yes, we tried. And the sick, twisted nature of all of it is, you can call yourself a Christian nowadays, and it doesn't really affect this. Because that's a little meaning. But you say you're a servant, and I'm going to ask you those questions. I'm going to ask you as a servant, do you have a right to tell God, well, once I'm fully satisfied, once I get my way, my little pet peeves, my little desires are all that matters. Once those are satisfied, I'm good. Or do I actually have to come to God and say, you are the boss? You say jump, I say. So tonight we have a simple lesson that's really hard to get. And it's this. Do servants sit in pews and go about their day? Do servants come to a building that we built so it looks like a Catholic church, giant A-frame? White walls, because I don't know, we always have white walls. White outside the building. Yeah, it's always this way. Do servants come and they sit in pews? No, just lazy people do. Lazy people, they come, they sit in pews. They listen to stories so that they can hear something new. So that they can gain knowledge. Wait, that's just lazy. Servants don't do that. Servants come together and they say, you know what, okay, here's how we got a job. We got to plan this out. We got to work together. Okay, you're going to be taking care of this side. You're going to be taking care of this. And we're going to come together. And when we come together, we're going to do something great. This temple is going to be built because you know what? You're not going to sit there. You're not going to sit there. You won't sit there. You'll get up Monday morning and you'll say, how about we rebuild this? We know what God wants. And so, if Christianity involves sitting in pews, I like the term servant. If my servant's just sitting around, sitting in a pew, I'm actually upset. If God's servant, and the only thing they consider is let me hear more and soak in more and be fed more, I just think they're gluttonous. But if they're waiting till Monday morning, and Monday morning is about, you know what, I know what God wants from me, I'm going to do something. Yeah, I'll be there at church so I can be fed and be re-energized, and I can reorganize, and I can get set, and I can plan this out, and I can get ready, and this temple will be rebuilt, and this temple, I don't even care what happens to us. Because this story is about rebuilding the temple, but the story of the church is about a church that takes over the world. Because they met together in a house that was effective. Terry has a list of names. I don't know. Yet. I want to know, but not yet. I don't know how many people realize she has a list of names and said, if you're willing to talk to people about God, send cards, make phone calls, visit them. I don't know how many she has. I'm going to hope every single person of y'all are like, how come you only have 10? There's more than 10 of us. We need more. Go get more. Terry, you're doing a terrible job. Go get us more names. I would love to think that. I really think that some of our Christianity consists of the pew-sitters. Never get anything built. They wait for God to get through all their little things. Because how many of y'all can honestly say you don't have the right cards? Make a phone call or visit. You have three options, right? There's probably like 15. You could probably email me on some of them, right? Email. For those of us who don't know how to write them. And I want to ask you to consider this right now, to judge yourself right now, and consider what you have said to her. She said, I have people who are searching for God who need to be contacted. I want you to consider yourself why your name is not on her list. And the reason I'm good with this is I have no clue what I'm looking at. And if your Christianity never changes anything from Monday to Friday, then you're a Christian, but you're not serving the King. Tonight we have an invitation. The invitation is the invitation of Lordship. Not when we use the focus on, do you believe that Jesus is Lord? Do you repent of your sins? Do you confess Jesus as Lord? Lord, Lord, Lord. Are you buried in submission to your Lord so that you're raised up as a servant? Your life is dead and in his hands. He took that old thing away. It now belongs to him. It's all his. So that you then live for him, and in this life he continues to cleanse you, and you continue to hang on to your Lord. And wait for that day when it's no longer a kingdom of separation, but it's a kingdom where we walk before the King, and at his very throne room we get to bow before him and sing praises and worship our King. And he looks at us and he says, "Well done, my good and faithful servant," instead of, "Hey, you found a seat, didn't you?" Because God calls us to be servants. Not a modern concept of Christianity. A servant. And the second invitation is that you may have one time called him Lord, but today he called him Lord. Is there something in your life that you understand is no longer below him? Do you call him Lord? And for that we offer, or anything else you need prayers for, we offer that invitation. And if you wish to submit to the eldership, we offer those invitations as we sing.